Good morning. My name is Lawrence Vine. I'm Principal Horn with Canada's National Arts Centre Orchestra. We are here today on the unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe Nation. Now I'd like to introduce our masterclass artist for the morning, Gail Williams. Gail is a legend in the horn community. She served for many years as the Associate Principal Horn with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra. She has graced stages around the world as an orchestral principal and a soloist. She is renowned as a chamber musician and recording artist. As a pedagogue, she has maintained an extraordinary studio at Northwestern University's School of Music for many years. And her masterclass for NACO's mentorship program last year was one of the real highlights for all the brass players, and we are extremely fortunate to have her back again this year working with our participants. So please join me in welcoming this morning's artist, Gail Williams.
Good morning. Nice to see you, Larry.
Hello, Gail.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Thank you.
My name is Chia-ying, and I come from Taiwan. I recently studied in Montreal for my diploma. And for today, I bring some excerpt. I'll start with Brahms 3, and then I have Mahler 3. And if we have some other time, we can go with our Bach.
Okay. Nice, really very, very nice. I'm just gonna kind of go straight into what I like to do on this work, because I think this is one that you will be playing for every single audition, you know, and it could be for school, it could be festivals, it'll be for principal horn, associate horn, assistant horn, everywhere, right? Mm-hmm. So why do they ask this?
I would say they can really see if you have a good rhythm.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's a lot of like dotted and then like and then it come from upbeat. So okay. Very good. Okay. And it also can show your musicality.
Right. I think it has to show your legato playing. And so I will say today a number of times, there are some things that you have to always show in your auditions, and that is great time, mm-hmm. good intonation, and what else?
Time, intonation.
Right? But then you can start with the C words, I like to say, all right? So contrast, character. Because in auditions, you need to have different
dynamic.
That's correct. Mm-hmm. Dynamics, curiosity of why are they asking this, you know, too. So I think you're absolutely correct in the flow of it. Mm-hmm. I know that when I've practiced this before performing, many times I've flutter-tongued it. Do you flutter-tongue?
Yeah, for the whole room.
Yeah, just go ahead and flutter tongue the whole thing and see if you can see anything different.
Are you
Okay, so if you can flutter tongue softer. Let me move a chair out of the way. Learn to flutter tongue really soft and really compact. Okay, so what does that do for you? Anything?
Can I try the beginning without the flutter tongue again?
Yeah.
The
to bring your air far a little bit forward. Mm-hmm. So I think that's what I want to hear in your sound. I want to hear it a little more compact out here, out in the front. So blow through your lips. So it's really up there. Practicing soft flutter tonguing is very good for you, not just loud. So do it one more time, the whole on solo for me. Think. You're going to, I see this in blue. I see these in all different colors of blue. So as you get more intense, it becomes a little bit darker blue, mm-hmm. and it comes back out, you know? So very legato, but keep that pulse. The one thing I would say is you're in your five, make it a little bit more 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, not 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. It's coming out. Have it come much more, equal. It's coming out a little tossed off. And I think this is one that if you played it on the natural horn, you'd probably play it very equal. Mm-hmm. Da, 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 you know, that way. When you take your breaths,
where?
No, when you take them, can you make sure that you're not cutting off, like the very first breath you take after in the second bar, it's pretty snappy. So it ends abruptly. Can you kind of caress it a little bit more with your lips? Try it one more time. More like that, because I think you want it to be like a cello changing their bow, not grabbing a breath. So you're not, I didn't hear it as much. And I'd heard that when you took the breath, it kind of was like a little choppy before. But that's, you have a really nice sound. You're making really beautiful phrases. I love how you're not going in the third little phrase, you're not making a huge crescendo, decrescendo to the A flat, written A flat, because there's, at that point, there isn't one. And you're balancing out the dynamics well. Let's go on to the next one. Why is this on lists?
I just put everything I think I need help.
Oh, okay. So why do you think people are asking this? This is on a lot of lists.
Like, I think for Brom 3, just like you say, in every almost every audition, they will require for this one. And then I feel that I found different opinion every time when I bring it to different teacher. And then mm-hmm. I take all thing and then create my own version. And then for Mahler 3, this is kind of like, I pick it from the second horn audition list and also the Bach. Mm-hmm.
So why do you think they're asking this on the second horn list?
Well, for the Mahler 3, it will show like your flexibility of the low register for sure.
Is this the, which Mahler is this? The low one?
The second horn one.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. The intonation, the flexibility, mm-hmm. power, mm-hmm. character. So let's see what you do. Okay, very nice. I have a feeling that if you played this in an audition as you just did, mm-hmm. people would say your rhythmic pulse is not strict enough. Mm-hmm. It may be in a performance the conductor could do all of that, mm-hmm. you know,
yeah.
but most of the time I think it's got to be a little bit stricter in an audition.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, be careful, like at 30, when you take a breath after the written A's, you're taking a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
So I would recommend highly that you would play with a metronome mm-hmm. and get it really strict first, then add some of the nicht breit and the rubato to that rhythm. Because I think it's a little unstable right now with the time. When you get to, well, just in the beginning, in the very, very opening, some people would like to hear the first two notes in the old retard tempo, mm-hmm. and then at 29, it's the new tempo.
Mm-hmm.
Some people want to hear it in the new tempo. So I think you have to be flexible, so you practice it both ways.
Okay.
Da-da-dum, da-da-dum, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Or is it da 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 ta ta ta? So you have accents
at the second
low, no accents, mm-hmm. and accents on the third full bar, etc. So be really exact with this because Mahler wrote everything in that he wanted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I always say you don't have to be a genius to play Mahler. You just have to be a good athlete and be able to read. You know, and this. I think this excerpt is really important for the second horn because not many second horn parts are written in fortissimo up to a high B.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to show them that you're going to be supportive of that first horn,
okay.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes to putting the bell up, I don't recall when you brought it back down. Are you bringing it back down on
it's
the...
It's before the long, like the low, the middle E.
Yes.
I thought that then I bring it already been.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So still make them the quarter, the half note triplet, still ta, ta, ta. Make sure they're like nice big bows,
mm-hmm.
you know, not too short. The eighth notes at the end of that one, two, three, fourth line.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't play them so short. I think they will be short enough if you just keep them ta 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 ta, not ta 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 ta. You know, add a little more length. This is a little different style than if you were playing Haydn or Mozart or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's do it again and see if you can pay really close attention to keeping the rhythm a little stricter with a little bit of flexibility. And pay attention to all of the accents, kind of, you know, big bows accent this way, down bows, but not light.
Okay.
Yeah, I think that's a little stricter, and I think that would be more acceptable. And maybe in performance, you would do as much flexibility as you had in the first time. Once in a while, I like at 30, I'm not gonna play real loud here. Da, da, da. Keep the vowel very much present, not just the articulation. You can get those accents with your air. I didn't articulate at all. So get the vowel through that way a little bit more, because it's coming out not quite an even triplet. And I think you could have a little bit more sound. This other part here, I think it's too short.
Still too short, okay.
Yeah. Slur it once. Slur it. Yeah, and feel how your air has to flip through those notes. Do it again. Right. Now articulate on top of the air. Yeah. I think you'll find that that'll project that sound instead of ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, you know, kind of thing. Getting the horn up, I think you got to be careful not to twist your lip. I think you're doing that a little bit. What do you think?
Yeah.
Can you do it right on the bottom E? So you're kind of playing that note, taking a quick breath in, and then moving your horn up. Yeah. In an audition, I would not, you know, do that. I would just go right straight up. Because you don't have anybody to bug. You don't have a neighbor.
I have so just only wool here.
Yeah. So just put the horn up there so it doesn't twist your face as much. I think that's what you did.
Like this.
Yeah, just straight up like that. From there, try there. Isn't that easier on your face?
Yeah.
Yeah. So coming down. You know, I probably have my bell up. So I would take a breath and move it down on the A.
Okay.
Instead of twisting your lip on the E. I think that's kind of tough on your face. It doesn't specify when to bring the bell down, but that's a time where you can make a decision with a section. But for an audition, I would make sure that I wouldn't be twisting my lip around, you know. Yeah, right. Right. Good. Any questions?
We also did that di-da-di-da-di, like very like tenuto thing. Like, do you want to show the accelerando there or?
A little bit.
Da-da-da-da.
It can, it's just so different there. I've done it so many different ways with different.
Yeah, I think I'm going to like, play really in tempo and then pick some place to like flexible. That's what you mentioned about.
Yeah, I think you can keep it fairly strict, and then when you play the E to the C, you can kind of rush it just a little bit.
Okay.
Bum ba 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 bum. Mm-hmm. You know.
Okay.
Just a little bit. Because if you're playing this in an audition and you have to sustain through to where it says out tempo, how are they going to know what you're doing? They're going to be counting. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's hard. It's hard when you have that kind of flexibility. But I think the main thing for me would be in this, I always like to write little cards, you know, and I would say one word on the front. I would probably say, I might just say powerful. That might be my cue word. Mm-hmm. On the back, I would say articulation, time, you know, keep a steady tempo through some of these long notes and show the difference between accented and non-accented notes, etc. Those kind of bullet points. So when you're preparing for an audition, you can just look at it, remember what you need. You can always subtract and can add mm-hmm. to those cards. Okay. Yeah, very good. You want to do the next one?
Sure.
Okay, good. I don't think you need to play it any louder mm-hmm. in an audition. I think it sounds big enough, mm-hmm. you know, because when you're by yourself on stage, sometimes that's pretty loud.
Okay.
It's always difficult to know how to play this area before 56 and afterwards mm-hmm. in an audition, right? Where do you take these breaths? What is the most important part from 56 out? What do you think?
For me, or do you want me to like guessing what I want to hear?
Yeah, what do you think is important?
I think like the eighth, the mi should be fluent and then continue to the
okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, I agree. Mm-hmm. But I think it's also the intonation. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't work for me to play with you, but I would say get a trombone player. Okay. Get somebody else besides a horn player so you can hear the different sounds, okay? And play that concert A. Mm-hmm. So you're tuning those notes.
Okay,
back up to the concert. So that concert A is always there, mm-hmm. right? And you're tuning those intervals to that because it wasn't quite right. Mm-hmm. I think that's a big reason why they asked this, to see if you have the power mm-hmm. to go up and do the first section of it and then to make that beautiful slur. So I liked where you took your breath, mm-hmm. but I think you need another one because I think you run out. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm. Where did you take it before? Did you play?
It's one bar before.
Or did you take one? Where did you take a breath?
I take only before, one bar before 56.
And then before that?
I think it's 1, 2, 3, 4 bar before 56.
All right. Mm-hmm.
before the A.
Can you just play the whole thing and I'll pay really close attention to where you're taking breaths, because maybe you're getting just a little too low. So if you can think about taking breaths sooner and keep filling up all the way up to your collarbones. So when you take that breath in the bar before 56, you might have a little bit more fuel in you, okay?
Okay.
Let's do it the whole thing again. Really strict tempo. This is another one for me. I have had students practice and I practice. I go ahead and flutter, get that air through my lips. Yeah. You don't need to do that now in your practice. Something that was kind of drilled into my head by Mr. Jacobs when I took a lot of lessons with him. Never sacrifice tone for air. So you're probably not a really tall person, right?
No.
No. Sure. So you're going to need more air. I do too. I mean, I'm not very tall. And I think you showed a really nice, you showed that really well. However, the breath before 56, it was not a very good breath. It was a little grab. So would it be beneficial for an audition if you took a breath? You took one there. I still have water in my heart. Can you make it through this? And take a breath before the low F sharp. See if you can get through. So take a breath, play 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bars before 56. Take a breath before the A. And maybe one before the long E, and then make the slur, and then take a breath before the F sharp. See if you can get through there.
Okay.
Maybe play that whole third line. Right. So that's a little bit more comfortable, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do me a favor. Take your third slide on your F horn and pull it out like this much. All right. Now play the low E. Now play the low F sharp. Take a breath. Play the low F sharp. Does that seem to be a little bit lower? So maybe you don't use that third slide on the F horn in this.
This one.
So you can always make a little mark in the part, pull slide. That's what I do. So you can get a little bit lower, because that's just not a very nice note. You know, and I don't think, are you using third valve on the low A? Are you doing that or one and two?
Not at the low A. For the like the lower, like if it's one, two.
Yeah, so you're not using that. You're not using the F side of the thirds at all, except for that low C, G sharp, or F sharp. Right. So you can just then after that low E, then you just push it back in. But that seems to help center it a little bit.
Thanks, good. Gail. If it's okay, I think it's good to move on to the next student, if that's
okay. Okay. Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Bravo to you.
So the next student, the next participant of the NACO Mentorship Program coming up to play for us is August Haller, and he'll introduce himself a bit more when he comes to the front.
Okay.
Hello. It's good to see you again.
Hi, August.
How are you doing?
Good, fine. How are you?
I'm great. I brought a few excerpts and the exposition of Mozart 3. That's okay.
Okay. Like that on my iPad just a minute. Go ahead. I think I probably will know them all.
Is it okay if I stand? Will be the sound okay?
So do you want to run an audition? You want me to give comments now?
I think I prefer comments now. And
okay.
Yeah.
One, be aware of how much you're moving.
Okay.
Put the music through the horn, not just for people to watch. Okay. I'm not a stick in the mud that you have to sit there like a stone, but I feel like you can do some motion, but this is a moving target.
Right.
You know, and you had a few little blurps that you don't need to have, but as you're moving. Also, the students here at Northwestern kid me because they think I'm a posture queen. Yeah. But I think it's really important that you're kind of going down. I see the top of your head. I don't want to see the top of your head. I want to see this open. Stand back up and play the opening again.
Sweet.
Keep your feet really nice and planted. You need to put your music stand up. Put your music stand up.
Cool.
Yeah. And keep this part of your body nice and open and soft. Right? So I feel like I feel like that has a little bit more ring in the sound that I can hear. Now I want you to play. Play all the eighths. Watch the 16ths. Yes. Okay, so what's different?
I rushed the 16ths.
Yeah, you really do. You really compressed them. Yeah. And that's, many years ago when people played Mozart before an audition, everybody said, oh, it's just kind of their warm up. No, it's not. It's your first impression. And if you come out and play Mozart and not in great time, I know that Norman Schweigert would have already written on his card, bad rhythm.
Yep.
So you don't want to give that impression. You've got to come out with the right stuff, right? So you have a lovely sound. You're going to keep this nice and open. And you're going to, what's your word that you want to say?
Let's go with playful.
Playful. Okay, great. So do the whole thing for me again. I want to hear playfulness. I want to hear good time. Try to think about this being up and resonant, this area. You don't have to pull it up because then you pull in, you know, just think nice and soft and high. Okay, what did you think about that one?
It felt a lot cleaner, and I think it felt mostly better. I think I didn't quite get the character I wanted, but.
Okay. Sometimes I think you could go to the appoggiaturas a little bit more. Okay. Just, you know, keep the playfulness in there, but I would also say sing. Okay. So you're always singing, you know, you're always making a beautiful statement. And some little, you know, a little contrast. I like what you're doing with the contrast. I think it's very good. Just don't overdo it.
Okay.
Don't overdo it because I think that brings attention to the wrong part of what you're trying to do.
Gotcha.
But I think some of the, I think you could do a little bit more. Think natural horn a little bit more, how it would shade things, you know? Yeah, very good. Let's go on to the excerpts.
Cool.
What are you going to be playing?
How about we start with Till 2829? That's okay.
Is this a second horn excerpt or what? First horn?
Third horn.
Okay. All right. Thank you. That's the section you have to do?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I feel that, and this is over Zoom, so I can't say it exactly, but I feel that you could have more dynamic contrast. The louds are loud enough. I think there are times where the softs could be a little softer to show that loud. So the little details, like after 30, where you have forte, there's a mezzo forte with a diminuendo forte, and then mezzo forte again with a crescendo to that. I think you can show that width of the variety of dynamics.
Yep.
Right? I don't think you need to articulate harder. I think you need to think about blowing through a little bit more.
Okay.
Right? Because it's coming out like kind of this. Okay. And I think that's fine, except that you need to have the air going through. So let's just do the call again. That is piano. Yeah, right?
Yep.
And only up the forte.
Okay.
Open up. Are you opening up your hand when you go low?
Probably not enough.
Just think of a rudder, you know?
Okay.
Okay, so that's a little bit better. August, get your metronome going, whatever tempo you like. One, two. Just the first three notes, five times. One, two, there. Just go three notes to the second beat.
Okay.
No. I want you to play the first three notes. So you're just going to go.
Okay.
So put your metronome on and you're going to go. And you're going to stop on the next second beat of the second bar because it's getting squished just a tiny bit. No. Listen, this is, I don't know if you can hear what I'm playing.
Sorry,
but
I'm so sorry.
Go to the second beat of the second bar. So it's, and you can land on that A. So you're going to nail that second beat every time. Okay, then you're going to go to the next bar and land on the G, which is the second beat of the third bar. Right. So you get your metronome going and no one is going to knock you off that.
Okay.
Okay. And I think you'll find that you're sometimes trying to hang on to those D sharps just a smidge too long.
Gotcha.
And that is like, as Alan Civil said to, in a masterclass way back when, he said, that's like doing this. That's what Till was doing, right? Yeah. He's thumbing his nose and it's a little quirkiness. So you could land on it and release. So that's your little twisty because you got a half step going to that E.
Yep.
Right? Try it the whole thing now. Just the call. Yeah. Right. Can you do this? Yeah, the middle note, the G or the written E.
Yep.
What do you think is in the way?
Probably my tongue.
Yeah, now play it open on the horn. Open your hand. It's because it's low. Yeah, just look at the, you know, check it out with the intonation with the tuner. This is a little low. But that helps center those notes so much, so you're kind of scooping it from the bottom.
Yep.
I hear bom, bom, bom. You want to hit it like bells or whatever you can imagine, you know.
Yep.
And then the next calls. Be careful that you're not quite landing on the second beat of the second bar of all those calls.
Okay.
Right? Let's go on after the six bars. Okay, good. So, have you ever played all this on your mouthpiece? I won't have you do it now, but I think it would be a good idea because I think you'll find it.
Okay.
You know, you're chirping on some notes that, for example, you're going, yeah, I bet you it's doing a little whip-whip, right?
Yeah.
And then I think you're whipping there.
Yep.
So just, you know, that's something you can check on your own.
Okay.
Now, 31, you have how many sequences?
Three. Well, two.
So the third one has to be like, that's the final one.
Yeah.
So they all kind of came out the same. If you can think full bows, you know, full bows on those, but the second one's going to be maybe a little bit more. And then the third one is more. And then it's interesting that the bar before 32, he reiterated the fortissimo.
Yep.
So it seems like it has to kind of go to that last one a little bit more. So let's do 31. Good. Does that seem any different?
Felt more powerful, better.
Yeah. So I think you just leave a little bit. I know that Barenboim always wanted to say, make sure you save a little bit for the third one, you know, even though it's a longer phrase and you will have a tendency to go a little bit further. But I think, da 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 ta ya da da. And you know, what did you say? Oh, that's what you said, you know, have a conversation. Good. Let's go on. What's your next one?
How about Don Q, Variation 8, or something different?
Go ahead. Just pulling it up. What part? Second or fourth?
Second.
And which variation?
Eight.
All right. I'm going to say something about your posture, okay? I feel like you're going to your horn.
Okay.
Do you feel that?
I feel
like you're doing this.
Yep.
And for me, that doesn't help my low stuff because it's tucking this in.
Right.
So get yourself up in the horn above your head and bring it back down. And now play the first phrase. I don't know if it's a lot different what you just played, or if it's a different miking or something, but that's totally different here.
Okay.
It's more open. It's not as bumpy. It was soft. But I think you can do that.
Yep.
Okay? Do it again. Just let's go from after 60. Do the low C one, because I want to hear your accelerando again.
Sure.
Bring the horn up to you. You're going back down again. Okay, so my question is this. I know there are many different recordings and people do this, but in the score it says un poco accelerando. When does the accelerando stop?
It doesn't until like the bar before tempo.
And so I think you need to show in an audition that you're continuing.
Yeah.
Right? It kind of slows down. Ba-da-lum, da-da-lum, da-da, da-da, da-da. Like it's really anxious, you know?
Gotcha.
And so you can keep that moving. And they're all about those little half steps. You know, keep it moving forward. And then when you come back to tempo one, that's when it's back to the slow.
Right.
Yeah. So I would just show more of what you're doing. Go from, do you notice anything if you sit up taller?
It sounds better.
Yeah. Besides, sounds better. Is it easier air in?
Maybe a little bit more, yeah.
Yeah, because you're really, it's like, Mr. Bowen and I call that turtle. You bring your head out of the shell, you know. Keep your head up there where it should be. Have you done any Alexander technique stuff?
No, I haven't.
Yeah, that would be, I'm sure they would immediately help you with that. And just show you the difference, yeah. Because you want this to be, this is your sounding board. And if you do this, you cut it out.
Yep.
So So keep that up. Just go from before 61, three bars, and show me a little bit more accelerando with that dynamic. Yeah, good, good. And this is another one that you could go. If you want to flutter, learn to flutter really soft, bring that air forward. It helps make it smooth. Very good. Another one, quick like.
All right, Pavan?
Yep. Okay, so having to switch gears, you know, what do you have to say to yourself to switch gears to play Pavan compared to what you've just been playing two octaves lower?
I'm not totally sure.
What about your airspeed?
Airspeed.
Okay. Right, so you know what 2 + 2 is, right? 4. So that's the fourth partial. What's 4 + 4?
8.
You can do that in any crook, right? So go on to your G crook. So what partial are you playing when you first start?
8.
Okay. So think that airspeed. If you've had something that you've just been down in the basement, and you're like on 2 or 3 or something like that, which you were. Now you just gotta think about, boy, I gotta throw that much faster air. Like, so you're gonna take that camera lens and dial it down. You're not gonna cut the air off. You're just gonna dial it down so it can go a little bit faster. No tongue this time. Now add your articulation to that air. Right. So that's something you can practice. Yep. Getting the timing. So I think you're depending on that instead of do like, you know, like the old thing that kid would put an egg on your head and kind of do that. You kind of want to think that. You don't want to think bang with a tongue.
Right.
Small case T, larger U. Yeah. Do it again. 8th partial. Right. So now for the heck of it, you're not gonna stay in your G crook. Just go the first two notes on your G crook. Right. Now add your valve to that. That's the idea. So the second phrase play it all in 1 and 2, B flat horn, your G crook. Okay. get it with your air, not your left hand. So that's practicing. I'm not saying to play it that way.
Right.
That's to a pretty good intonation because of the natural horn part.
Yeah.
Change of valve, it gets you to make your air flow correctly in the speed. Then you add your valves and it should be even smoother.
Okay.
Good. Thanks very much, Gail. Thank you, August. Thank you. I think we'll move on to the next participant, if that's okay. This will be Rachel O'Connor.
Hi, Gail. My name is Rachel, as Kelly said. It's good to see you. You may remember me from the Festival of Peru where I got stuck in the horn dress. It's great to see you. I was going to start with Don Quixote, fourth horn, variation 7.
Another one that I always ask, why do you think they're asking this? So on the back side of your card, you would have what?
Pulse, like duple to triple, and all the rests, as pitch as well for all those arpeggios, and sound through the low and mid register.
And the legato part of it.
And the, right.
Yeah. So on the front side of this, what do you think you'd, what's your character or your cue word that you want to have? I think this stuff is from Don Green, and I think it's really important.
Right.
Because it gets you out of, oh crap, here comes this excerpt.
Right. Maybe connected.
Okay. Okay. I think I'd my word would be flow.
Mm. Okay.
It's a little more simple. Mm-hmm. I like four-letter words. You know, mm-hmm. Sing, flow. So I think this, you need to pay attention to the rests a little bit more.
Right.
I think I would back off 5% of your sound.
Okay.
I think you're trying to play really loud, and I think it needs to be full.
Okay.
Not forte, it's just full.
Right.
And have you subdivided it? Da 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 da. Like you're really gonna hit the next bar.
Right.
Have you done that?
I have, but it's been a while.
Okay. So I think you should go back and revisit that.
Yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
What helped me in this the most was to think that I'm blowing my air to the third note of every triplet.
Okay.
That going forward instead of the low note. I think you're going down, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think you have to think that way, you know, you're going to go going through. So in that, let's do it one more time. Pay really close attention to the A's. That's a third,
mm-hmm.
A little high.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I always figure third valve because it helps me not be so high on that note.
Sure.
And then I can continue blowing because I'm going up. I don't want to go higher in pitch, just, right, you know, hitting the middle of the note.
Great.
Just try it one more time.
Sure.
Really pay attention to your rhythm. I feel like your middle C is too short.
Okay.
Can you play da 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 da? Yes. So do it a couple, you know, do the first two phrases that way and then drop the articulation. So your rest, at least from, I don't know if it's Zoom, be careful that when you finish the half notes that it immediately starts counting again. It's a little long.
Okay.
It could be Zoom, you know?
It's probably me. Do you want me to do that again with a subdivision or?
No, but do you feel the difference?
Definitely, yeah.
And what also happens when you put in subdivision, the line gets longer.
Right.
Let the rhythm help the line.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Do the whole thing again. I'm going to pay attention to something else. So that's too low.
Okay.
If you no, that's too low. Can you go a middle C? Does it feel pretty centered? Well, I think the air is here, not spread this way.
Right.
I feel like when you get to middle C, it gets more spread.
That makes sense, yeah.
It's something that goes thin for me. Keep it centered.
Yeah, it felt easier.
How's the pitch? What's
that?
The pitch okay?
I'm not sure.
I would get my tuner out and just check it. I feel like it might be a little high, but it may be the low C is a little low, you know?
Right.
I don't know. But you'll just have to do it on your own. Go ahead and do the whole thing and keep it, your eyes on that third note of the triplet so the air keeps going forward.
Better. I do feel I need to work on the subdivision, but the air felt
better. I think that'll be your project, is the subdivision. Mm-hmm. Be careful of the intonation. Mm-hmm. My big question is, maybe before 58, you're getting too loud because there's not enough contrast between the forte and fortissimo.
Okay.
Da, 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 yeah, you know, kind of thing. And then there's not a diminuendo written. So right. You might do that in the orchestra, but I think in an audition, I think you got to play it really quite full.
Okay.
Great. Next one.
Mahler 355, fourth horn.
In general, I think that's going to be loud enough. I'm not positive, you know, for the fortissimo. I think it can be less this and more this. Bum, 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 bum. It's always how you treat that stupid middle C. That eight. Is it? Sing it. Can you sing it once? Do and do. Do, do. Okay. So you don't whack it and it doesn't come out short.
Right.
Ooh. So there's still some body to it. Right. So it's an arc like this, you know?
Right.
Same thing with the next one. Ooh. It's not totally soft. It's not chopped, but you've got to put it as part of the phrase. So I would say if you practice the first two phrases, first maybe on your mouthpiece to see what you're doing, sank it, maybe not so loud, maybe do it mezzo piano and see where the music is. Right. Let's try that. Let's do the first two phrases, mezzo piano, all legato, find out where you want the phrase to go. Exactly. So now do that in fortissimo, in articulation, but make sure you're going to those downbeats. Pick up to the downbeats. Yep. Maybe the E is a little too soft, but I like the phrasing of it much better.
Okay.
So it's not just aggressive.
Right.
There's music in there too.
Right.
Bum, 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 maybe, I don't know. You know, ask a cellist how they would bow it and take that as an example and try it out. Let's go to the nitty gritty of this stuff. So I felt like you were almost out of air also on that E, and then the schwer part.
Yep.
Have you ever experienced pulling out that third slide on the F horn?
No, I meant to do that. That's a great idea. for
this. Just try it, because I think it's going to help your low G also, because that's a little high in the last couple bars.
Okay.
Start there, so you get a running start of see where your air is.
Okay.
Seem to center it a little bit better for you.
Yeah, and I changed the breathing to how you had Jessica do it.
That all depends on you. Yeah. You know, some people that have come in and played, they don't have a very good E to E slur. Mm-hmm. They don't have a very good slur. So I said, maybe you could take a breath there.
Right.
And then not, if you have a good slur from the low E to the low F sharp, don't take a breath there. So it depends on you, because in the orchestra, you have to breathe all over the place, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm having a problem here explaining. My tongue is not hard. It's not going. I don't know if you can hear the difference.
Yeah, I can.
Mm-hmm. But I feel like it's not as sustained-ish. It's not really sustained, but it is sort of in that character, you know? March-like, bum, 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 bum. It's sort of this nice, strong bows. And I feel like it's a little too vertical.
Right.
Yet.
Mm-hmm.
Be careful of. I think it's coming away too much.
Mm-hmm.
So go in between, you know. Can you do the whole thing for me again?
Yep.
I know what I want to say. I don't have it here. It's on my studio desk. I feel like you could suck in a little bit more air if you thought about an exercise that Mr. Jacobs did with me. I have a tube that's about that long. It's about 3/4 of an inch. So you can go to the local hardware and get a little plastic tube. I have them in my studio. I cut them up. This is what I was doing last week. It was like, get your tube out, you know. And he would have me take 3 breaths. He'd have me put it here, which kind of made me have a good hand position,
right,
and take 3 breaths, but on the 3rd one, keep sucking in and start playing. So if I were to go, and just see what it feels like to you. See if you can get a little different kind of air in.
Okay, do you want me to do the 3 breaths?
Yeah,
okay.
I do. No, with the other hand. So you can really be ready. 3 breaths. Keep your tongue low. The difference?
I felt a lot more free and the sound felt better. I felt
okay.
Yeah.
Where did it stop?
I think by the 3rd little phrase, the 2nd space A.
When you took a quick breath there.
Right.
It changed. Your whole tone changed.
Right.
And it wasn't because you were higher. I think it was the wrong kind of air.
Okay. That makes
sense.
So
that's just something you can do with anything. Three breaths. And I think you'll find that you have more sustained power. You'll realize that your tongue is out of the way when you're taking a breath, when you have that hose in your mouth.
Right.
So it's not going.
Yeah, right.
So it's more. I mean, the other thing with Mr. Jacobs, he would put my hand here and he'd say, now suck air in over your bottom lip. Mm. And you're kind of going. You want to hear that rushing of the wind. Yeah, that's good.
Right.
That's good. So start on the second line of this.
Okay.
You can just adjust it. You just have to practice that a little bit.
Right.
But you might find that you're getting in a little different kind of air.
Yeah, that's really helpful.
Because that first line was very different.
Right.
Yeah. It was this, not so vertical. Yeah.
Right.
So that might help.
Definitely, yeah.
Pay attention, you know, every time.
Great.
And in your practice, you can always stop.
Right.
Fix.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
You can play an etude, and every time you hear a kind of breath, stop, fix it, and then continue on, and then go back and see how often you can get that kind of breath in.
Right.
But he would say that to me over and over, you know, and sometimes just holding that tube in your hand reminds you to take that breath. It's kind of cool. Anyway.
Yeah. Awesome.
Do you have another one?
Smaller one? Do we have time for one more? Yeah. The low horn.
Very good. Is August right there?
Yep.
Do you have your horn out?
Yes.
I want you to be the timpanist. I want you to play, because I don't know if there's a delay here. Right? I want him to be your timpanist.
Excellent.
So you have to pay attention to the tuning and the time,
okay.
Right? August is just B flat and F, but you got to get your head up. Lift your horn.
Thank you.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
So that doesn't take too much, or someone can come and play those on the piano.
Okay.
Thank you, August.
Thank you.
So what did you find out?
The Fs were very bad. And yeah, just finding the pulse was different than I had been feeling it.
So, it could go that slow. It could go your tempo that you had going first, because it does move ahead a little bit usually there. But steady. Mm-hmm. You can't crunch the eighths a little bit. They're a little, just a little bit. Da-ya-da-da-da. You got to, it's a minor Berezjaka. And the tuning. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that low note. So it's, most people can't buzz down there. So I have them do it up the octave. And then when you do it down the octave on the horn, you just want to think thicker air and think about that partial, right? So if you can go. This is tender. You got to keep this engaged. To keep the steady. A little bit softer. I think that's something we forget on the mouthpiece. Mm-hmm. That if we're cranking away, that's right. Fine. We also have to play soft on it. So you can feel how that air is different. Okay, and then just think about thickening up the air and going a little bit slower.
Great, awesome.
A tuba player friend of mine, Dan Parentoni, I don't know if you know that name.
I don't know.
He's been teaching many years at IU. We did classes together one time and he kept saying to his students, what do you do when you have a hot potato in your mouth?
Right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
So think about that. Because you want to be playing with oh.
Right, right.
But play the, just play one of the phrases one more time.
I think that I'm being asked, I think my time has come and I'm cutting into someone else's time. So I might have to say goodbye now, but thank you so much. This was very helpful. Yeah. thank you, Gail.
Thank you, Rachel.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rachel. And our final participant for today is Taran Plamondon.
Hi, Gail.
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. I'm going to be playing the Hermann Neuling Bagatelle. So you can cut me off whenever you feel it is needed. Otherwise, I'll just keep going.
Are you playing this on a recital or an audition?
No, I've been avoiding learning it for my entire time playing the horn, and I used this masterclass as a sort of an opportunity to force myself to learn it. So.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Nice job. Very nice job. Good. My comments would be this, and just in general, I think you have a very good grasp on this piece. Your beginnings of phrases are really very good. I don't think you've put enough thought into the ends of your phrases. Do they continue on? Do they have this so the listener can have a breathing spot, you know, things like that. The very first phrase, it's a big long phrase and you use a lot of air. Are you out by the time you get to the end of the G?
No, to tell the truth, most of my stress in those passages comes from the quintuplet. I just don't have the fingerings in my head. But I think, like, I don't find that I have too much trouble making it to the end of the phrase.
Okay.
So, good. Yeah.
I'd probably have to take two breaths.
Yeah, I could probably, like, fit one in the middle if I really want to.
Somewhere in that quarter note triplet, maybe, to end up on the E a little bit stronger.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
You don't want to be kind of on the bottom third of your air capacity when you get up there. You want to be still pretty full. So on the quintuplet, are you counting it? How are you counting it?
I'm sort of just going, just I actually don't think of it as a quintuplet so much as a just sort of.
How about this is what Mr. Boulez used to say. You know, it's just five. You've counted for five for a long time. Count five. So 1, 2, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1. Say that. Organize it in your brain.
1, 2, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2.
Or, do it again.
I don't really know what number of numeral to give to the triplet, but yeah, yeah.
Just that bar. And that's what he would say all the time. He said, don't do 2 and 3 or 3 and 2. Count to 5, make it equal. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1.
Yeah. Yeah, I was kind of conceptualizing it as like 2 and 3, I think, but it's probably better to just, yeah.
Make it even. So it sounds different than the I think the real issue is most people get off the tie a little late. So the 16ths are kind of crunched,
yeah.
And then you have to crunch the next ones. So if you're 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, and that's exact. 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 1, you know, then you have time for the 5 and it's not such a panic.
Yeah, that makes sense.
All right. So let's go to the first couple phrases. Okay, did that seem to help to think counting it that way?
Yeah, I think maybe not sweating the quintuplet helps. I was thinking more about the 16ths and making sure that they were accurate. And so I didn't worry so much about the quintuplet that time.
I mean, fingering, which side of the horn works better for you?
I find my G so unusable on the B flat side that I actually switch back for that note. I don't know if that's a good move or not. Maybe that's what's throwing me off.
It depends on your horn.
Yeah.
I mean, it really does. I'm a very firm believer that you got to do all your scales in both sides of the horn.
Mm.
When I was young, okay, before I went to college, I didn't have a horn teacher. I had a double horn, but I didn't have a book that had the B flat horn fingerings. So I did everything on the F horn. And Mr. Covert said, "Don't you use that B flat side?" I said, "No, I could play all the notes." And so he made me do all my scales up and down. Up B flat, down F. Up F, down B flat. So in same thing with arpeggios. Both sides of the horn. So as you're going along, you're thinking, "Oh, I'm a little stiff today. It's not speaking. I guess I'm going to go on the B flat side."
Yeah.
And you can do it automatically. There are certain works that I learned never using 1 and 2 on the F sharp and 1 on the first on G.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because I didn't work on my other horns. And I wish I had learned them that way. Because on this horn, I can do that. And it keeps it kind of more consistent, I guess, instead of all of a sudden a different sound in there.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So I think you have to choose. I probably would do it on the F horn.
Okay.
You know, knowing that, not necessarily though, because Hermann Neuling was a really good horn player, you know, right? And have you worked on his etudes?
I have not, no.
Oh, you should look at the etude book that's got 30. And in the beginning of that book, he says there are optional notes to play. And there, because he wrote those optional notes, because most everybody during his time, they all played single B flats.
Really?
Hmm. Yeah, when I went over to Europe for a horn workshop, I think it was like 86, maybe, I don't know when I went, but Mr. Bauman said to me, you know, you're about the only person that's playing that has a double horn here. I went, so I've noticed.
That's shifted so that's, over the years then, hey?
It's changed, yeah, it's totally changed. But those etudes are very, they're not the most musical things in the world. They're very good for your playing. So you can look at those sometime. Q Press, you can get them on Q Press.
Cool. That's, yeah. I mean, I feel the same way about this piece. It's not the most musical thing in the world, but it's very fun. And I think it's also very, like, it gives you that challenge. It forces you to sort of.
Of course.
Yeah.
And it was never popular to play until when?
Until the European
William
orchestra started
the,
putting
Berlin
it on.
Audition.
Oh, yeah.
But. So I think it's just, I do think it's a good piece to learn to make it more facile down there, you know? I would just be really careful about some of the ends of the phrases so that you can be, like going into one. Da, ya, da, da, dum. Put an M on the end of the E. Da, ya, da, da, dum. And then it starts a different character from the first three lines, you know?
Yeah.
So maybe it's, you can have a storyline. Ba ba da 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 da. You know, you're kind of boisterous. I don't know, whatever you want to say. And then at one, maybe there's a little bit more tender moment that's coming in there.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So it's a very different character. So let's go from in the third line, the pickup to the second bar. No, I think you're doing this. You're kind of clipping that note. Oops. Instead of ba, ba, ba.
Ooh, sorry.
Really legato, blow the air between the notes. Okay, good. Look at the circle one again. A little bit more legato line when you play. Make sure you end that. And then you start the next phrase, okay? Because you kind of went. You know?
Yeah.
It didn't finish. You didn't put the M or the whatever end of the word. I feel this is such a fun piece. Da 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 da. That's where you're going, right?
Yeah.
So don't make that crescendo all in the beginning of the bar. Let it happen toward the end. Just go at one again, please. Okay, a question for you. When you started playing after one, one, two, three, four, the first measure of that line. Mm-hmm. Where were your eyes? Were they on every single note or were they on the G that you're going to?
I think I was pretty much parsing every note individually.
Okay. I want you to do it again. Start right on that bar.
No. That's not the right fingering. Hold on a sec.
Okay. That time your air was moving between the notes a little bit better, especially up there.
Yeah.
You weren't going. You cut off. Blow through. Good. Go on, please. Good. Now it says cadenza, so you don't have to keep it. You could mess with it a little bit, right?
Yeah.
No fear. Maybe molto return. I don't think the molto you have to do as much because it's kind of already written out.
Yeah, it's written in there, and.
But I think the first bar of that, I think you could mess with things if you wanted to. But going on at three, the storyline changes again. What happens here in the storyline?
I think there's sort of a tragic bent to this phrase.
Yeah, I always feel like the lady gets tied to the railroad tracks or something like that.
Yeah, it's a very brief moment of danger, which it ends. I mean, it's one of the few phrases I think that sort of goes a couple places before returning back to the home key. So there's potential for a lot of movement there.
So I would say change your bow. You're not coming from above. You're already on the string and you're just going to pull it. Think if you can change your air that way. Did you feel the difference of just trying different things with your air?
Yeah. I liked the bow analogy because I was just trying to do one really long, you know, I don't know. It doesn't map onto air one to one when I think of the bow, which I think is good. It's an abstract image that works really well.
Yeah, I use that a lot in my playing and my teaching because I can't see what you're doing with your air, but you can see out here, bow. And so you can imagine, I'm going to hook the bow. I'm going to be off the string. I'm going to be, you know, whatever, down, all down bows. Bom, 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 whatever, maybe.
Yeah. I like that. Like,
bom, 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 you know, you can toss it off a little bit more because it's just a showcase piece.
Yeah.
So going on, ta-da, da, da. I feel like it goes to the downbeat, not the low note.
That makes sense.
Right,
because the piano is doing the da dun da 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 da, and so right. It lands there.
Yeah, you're just accompaniment there.
Yeah.
So going on after those two bars down the next page, oh, buddy.
Or in the next page.
Okay, stop for a minute. So, where's the different characters here?
So I think of this, I think the first thing is still accompaniment, but it's sort of, I don't know, my concept of it is that he wrote it by accident. Like he wrote those three bars by accident and the phrase actually starts at five, but he like miswrote something. That's my like concept of it. So I try to play it that way.
Right, so I think also you could add to that, that maybe you could take a little time.
A little time, yeah.
So that, da, da, da. Ta ya dum, and really change the character.
Yeah.
It doesn't say to do that, but da ya dum, it's sort of a little fanfare-ish. Da ya dum.
Yeah.
Da ya da ya da dum. Ta da di ya da 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 ta di ya da 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 da. So don't not go to the second note of those triplets. I think you lost it there.
Sorry, don't go to the second note of the triplets?
Yeah, you went. I think you need to go through it. I don't think you should clip it.
Yeah, I see. Okay. Sorry, let me try that one more time.
Again. Work on this for a second.
Yeah, there's a lot there.
Would you please play from six for the first three bars, four bars? No, just three bars.
Okay.
Take your hand totally out of the bell. Yep.
Oh gosh.
You can hold on to your horn, but have it down here. I'm just going to prove a point because I think you're using your hand in there way too much for this low stuff. And I won't, you do move a lot. Maybe you should sit a little bit stiller, especially. You're moving around a lot.
Okay.
All right, just think about directing instead of moving back and forth, direct out of the top of your head. Now, this is something from George McCracken, who was a horn maker. He said, you really, all those notes work fine on the natural horn. I mean, you know, without your hand. Not the natural horn, but you know, you don't need your hand in the bell. So maybe think about opening it up a little bit straighter. So it's not here. So the sound just can come out, and then you can add your hand to that to enhance it.
Okay.
See, if you don't, I don't think you have to blow so hard. Good. So I think that just gives you another character and a little something else you can add to what you're already doing.
Yeah. Yeah. It feels super like exposed to me. Like I feel like I'm naked if I don't have my hand directly in the bell at all times. So I pulled it out a lot more than I was comfortable with just now, but I think it worked.
Now, Dick Merriweather, anybody know that name? Dick Merriweather?
I'm getting no's from the room. I don't know the name.
He was the main horn designer for the Paxman horns. And when I was over there in the early 80s, one time, he said, you know, you don't need your hand on the bell to do, and I will just do it like this. All the way up to high C. It gets really glissy up there, right? So all the way through, it's pretty slotted. So then you can start adding your hand to the bell and get to the point where, and it slots right up to high C or any harmonic, any crook you're using.
Yeah, interesting.
So it just shows that for a good octave and a half, those notes are going to be pretty slotted. So if you add your hand too much, you're just adding resistance and you're blowing against your palm. I'm not saying you take your hand out of the bell.
Yeah.
But you don't need your hand as much in the bell as you think. No.
Yeah.
And I know that Sarah Willis would say the same thing.
That makes sense.
But when she did a class last fall, she said, get your hand out of the bell. And I'm looking at the kids like, and I think you heard this before. You know? So it's important that you allow the horn to ring and not kill it by having your hand in there too far sometimes.
Yeah.
When you're playing things like Shostakovich 5, you're working hard exactly. If you put your hand way in that bell. Mr. Jacobs used to come and grab my hand, pull it out, and then he'd put a decibel meter on my stand and say, okay, now play it. Oh, do you want to play it like that or stick your hand back in the bell, you know?
That's funny.
And the decibel meter would go way down.
Yeah.
So it's just something you can experiment with and see where how far you go with it.
Hmm.
Very nice. You should put this on a recital.
Oh.
Thanks, Gail.
Thank you very much, Gail. Very nice to have you again with us this year. Merci tout le monde d'être venu dans la salle avec nous, and also thank you online, anybody who joined us online. We have a few more live stream events going on this week. Tonight at 7 p.m., we have an artist talk about women in orchestral leadership. So we'll be speaking with three concert masters who are women across Canada and the U.S. And on tomorrow night, we'll have a panel of participants from the NACO Mentorship Program who will talk about their experience in the program up until now. And on Friday, we'll have a masterclass with James Ennis. So I hope you can join us.
Oh, fantastic. Can I come?
Yes. So thanks very much once again, and we'll see you again soon. Thank you.
Thank you. Say hello to James for me, please.
Thank you. Thank you so much, James.